But for now, the biggest challenge facing Imperial Britain wasn't coming from the socialists, but from the growing industrial competition from Germany and the United States. Now Joe Chamberlain, the great imperialist, had found a new magic potion to build a stronger, greater British Empire for the new century. He returned to his old stomping ground to make the speech of his life.
On May the 15th, 1903, Joseph Chamberlain stood on this platform in Birmingham Town Hall and fired the first shot in an extraordinary guerrilla campaign to change the course of British politics. Everything the government thought was important would be swept to one side, he announced, for one issue. It was about the future of the British Empire. It was about where we stood in the world. It was about who would do well and who would go hungry. It had a very boring name, tariff reform. But it would tear this country in two.
Victorian Britain had been built on international free trade. It was almost a national religion. But now, both Germany and America were using import taxes or tariffs as a defensive wall to protect their increasingly mighty markets from British competition.
Chamberlain's response was beautifully simple. We should throw a similar wall around the British Empire. We'd tax all foreign manufacturers and food coming from outside, free trade inside. British industry would supply British colonies, the British colonies would feed the British people, and the clincher, the taxes on the foreign stuff would be spent at home on old age pensions. Everybody wins. Brilliant, except for this. Chamberlain's wall of taxes would have meant British industry becoming flabbier, less competitive compared to the Germans and the Americans. At the start of a new century, Britain would have been turning her back, flinching from the rest of the world. And most important, those taxes on foreign goods would make food at home more expensive, particularly harsh on the urban poor. Very soon, Chamberlain's critics were calling his tariffs stomach taxes.
Chamberlain had already torn the Liberal Party apart, and now he was working his dark magic on the Tories. A podgy young Conservative MP called Winston Churchill was so appalled by Chamberlain's protectionist campaign that he crossed the floor of the House of Commons himself and joined the Liberals. Scenting blood, the Liberal shadow Chancellor, Henry Herbert Asquith, went on the attack. Free trade or fortress empire? The argument raged for three whole years on platforms, in Parliament, and on music hall stages. But at the end of 1905, Joe Chamberlain was still making the political weather, still dominating the headlines. For 2.5 years he'd been campaigning for a fortress empire defended by protectionist tariffs. In the process, he'd split his own party, the Conservatives, in two. The Prime Minister sat uneasily on the fence while his government descended into civil war and the free trade Liberals were winning ground. Because Britain was never going to accept a policy that would increase the price of food.
Quite simply, Joe Chamberlain, the man who'd offered the British an alternative 20th century, had lost the argument. but he was going to draw blood and bring the Prime Minister down with him, and publicly he attacked Arthur Balfour as the lamest man ever to govern the march of an army. Last straw. In December 1905, Balfour called a general election, for one thing was certain: the Liberals couldn't win it. Could they not?
Balfour couldn't have been more wrong. The Liberals successfully positioned themselves as the party of the people. They campaigned on a manifesto of social welfare, free trade and reform, and they won a landslide victory. The Tories were annihilated. Even Arthur Balfour lost his seat.
"What a smash!" declared Chamberlain, who seemed rather chuffed that he'd now managed to destroy two political parties in the course of his extraordinary career. But his political failure over tariff reform was soon followed by personal disaster. 6 months after the general election, Chamberlain failed to turn up for a dinner appointment, and his wife found him lying helpless on the bathroom floor, struck down by a devastating stroke.
Joe Chamberlain never fully regained his extraordinary powers of speech, but through a miraculous effort of iron Victorian will, he did return to the Commons benches. And the man who'd set out to transform Britain in so many different ways now found Parliament radically changed. And more change, much greater change, was on the way. 29 new MPs dedicated to defending the interests of the working class were now sitting in Parliament. They'd soon take on a new name, the Labour Party.
That 1906 election was a big blow for country house government. A new generation was coming in. Asquith, Lloyd George, Winston Churchill. And as for Joe Chamberlain, who'd done so much to shake the old order, he was condemned to a pitiful parliamentary afterlife, left lolling voiceless on the benches he had once commanded. The last great Victorian radical could only watch as the young century's first great age of reform flared into life all around him.